Oh, did
Hello
we
and
lose it?
welcome to our first ever roundtable debate at the Flying In podcast. So this time we're trying something a little bit different, as opposed to the Oxford style where we practice oppositional debate, two sides and people argue over a certain resolution. In this particular form of debate, we're going to take on a general subject, have a number of questions, and then take turns going around and answering them. And hopefully controversy will come from that particular dynamic. So we're going to start with three questions broadly concerning the Syrian civil war specifically and foreign policy generally. And we have a number of people who have various different opinions, and I'll give everyone a chance to answer the questions. So I guess I'll just introduce the people who are speaking if you want to say hello. So let's start with Anarcho.
Howdy.
Fritz.
Yeah.
Jared.
Howdy.
Josh.
Good evening.
Blackjack.
Hi.
And Pius.
Are they?
So we're going to see what all these gentlemen's opinions are about recent events concerning foreign policy and their broader outlook on foreign policy generally. And I'm going to just give a general rundown of the situation before the question is asked. After the question is asked, I'll give everyone 5 minutes to answer it. Then we'll go into sort of a back and forth with me sort of putting my opinion in last. So with that being said, we can move to our first question. Question number one, is current US policy in Syria effective or justified? This will come in the middle of what I consider to be one of the most damaging civil wars in our lifetimes. This war started in 2011. It was really part of what was then considered the Arab Spring. Subsequently, we discovered that this Arab Spring was a winter and the entire Middle East fell into utter disrepair, most particularly Syria, which has been basically the site of nonstop warfare for the last 5 years now. Now, there's been a number of flubbed US policies leading up to this, particularly the Obama administration's decision to not intervene, create bright lines he wasn't willing to defend, and then followed up by Trump's, I would like to say, rather schizophrenic foreign policy. And now we're in a situation where I think very few people know what's going on, but we do seem to have somewhat of a foreign policy. So I'm going to bring the question first to Jared. What do you think is wrong or right with our foreign policy towards Syria and the Syrian civil war?
Well, I think you hit it on the head there with the schizophrenia part. I don't think Tillerson or Trump really know what they want to do in Syria, whether that's regime change or taking out ISIS or bolstering the Kurds or just drowning the Iranians in blood or whatever. The way I see it, what we have been most focused on ever since Obama has been to take down ISIS and, in the long run, strengthen a Kurdish autonomous enclave in the north. And we've been pretty effective at that so far, even with the Turkish intervention. And we're north of Raqqa right now. We have actually like ground troops, which no one seems to want to talk about. Probably because Obama's done most of the escalation and none of the media want or at least wanted to criticize him, even though he has kind of gone back on most of his promises, but he's no longer president, so that's not particularly relevant. And the way I see it, that as soon as ISIS falls, we're going to need to prop up some sort of Kurdish enclave to maintain influence in Syria. I don't think we can remove Assad, or we should, even though he's kind of a dirtbag. I don't see how a political solution in the Western Syria could work out in the long run without some even more corpses. So that's my two cents.
All right. Well, moving on to the next speaker, Josh, how would you like to answer the question, is U.S. policy towards Syria and the Syrian civil war effective or justified?
Okay. I guess my first question, it seems to be, I liked how you said schizophrenic, because I'm not really sure we even have a foreign policy at this point. We don't, we go from not having a war to bomb the shit out of them in the course of the same speech. I do like a more withdrawn type of intervention that we seem to be doing, where we're shooting missiles but not sending, at least not absurd numbers of troops. I'd say my biggest problem with our current policy of supporting the Kurds is that they are communists. I am not a fan of communism at all, and they're not quite the Stalin style. They're more of a super decentralized syndicalist communist. I think maybe there's an argument that they're the least bad, but because from what I've heard about their extremely slow bureaucratic process, funding them and supporting them is extremely burdensome. So we put in a lot of effort and get very little returns from it. I'd be more in favor of the Kurds in Iraq compared to the Kurds in Syria being given backing of the U.S.
Okay, anything more? You have 5 minutes, I should clarify. If you choose to.
No, that's all for now.
Okay, great. Moving on to Blackjack. What do you think, or should I say, do you think that the U.S. foreign policy is justified or effective in Syria, and your general reactions on that?
Well, so the justified question is a lot harder, so I'll skip that one for until after I answer the previous question of is it effective. And mm-hmm. It is effective in so far as that the only policy I've really seen as far as Syria goes that's been coherent and consistent is to degrade ISIS or to just eliminate the organization, although that's probably not going to happen. But and so it in that way, it has been very effective. As far as I don't really think that any, either the previous administration or this one, actually has a plan as far as the rest of Syria goes, as far as Assad or the rebels or anything. Just as an aside, while the Kurds are very communist, they are only part of the sort of Kurdish force that is up there. They've done a lot of rebranding, and they're now mostly Arab and Sunni, and it's a very interesting situation. But I just wanted to clarify that for reasons. So as far as justified goes, I would say maybe. It really just, again, depends on what the final goal ends up being.
Mm-hmm.
If do you want me to clarify that more? Or?
Take as much time as you want. I'm not interrupting you during these first 5 minutes during this round.
Oh, okay.
You can use as much time as you like.
So the reason I say maybe, and it depends on the final outcome, is that in general, just because we don't have a policy now doesn't mean that things can't change in the future. I mean, from what it looks like that Trump and Tillerson are actually working on an actual policy as far as Syria goes. And I would, that's what I'm waiting to see what that policy's justification is and how they plan on carrying it out. That's why I say maybe. So I guess that's all I really had to say on this round.
Okay, great. Let's go to Pius next. Do you think, or how do you think the U.S. policy in Syria is justified or effective?
So I honestly think that we've been butting our nose way too much into Middle Eastern politics, and I think it's probably about time that we step back and kind of let things just work their course. Of course, we should fight ISIS and the terrorists, but I don't think we should really be backing them, like, you know, like their enemies per se. I think we should let things run their course and stop intervening so much. And, you know, I want to What I'm trying to say is we should probably take a more isolationist policy towards the the whole situation right now, because as things are, really, no matter what we do, we're going to upset somebody. And as far as it goes as justified, I mean, I suppose I really don't think it was justified for us to, you know, shoot missiles at Assad when really there wasn't, you know, solid proof that the gas attacks were his doing. And I think that we should also think about whether or not it's justified to send the rebels, you know, like the Syrian rebels, money and weapons when we don't know whether or not, you know, they're being supported by the Islamic terrorists. So all in all, I mean, it really all depends on what lens you look through the conflict at. But as things stand, I can't really say I support what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I think we're running up on Anarcho. Your thoughts?
So I would say no to both accounts. And the reason why is, as a lot of people have alluded to, there just hasn't been that much coherency regarding this issue from the administration, from the mainstream media also. I was actually extremely baffled that in the lead up to this, before ISIS had taken hold in Syria, we heard a constant sound. We heard the drumbeat from the media of, we have to take out Assad. We have to take out Assad. Assad is a horrendous dictator. As soon as ISIS started to, you know, rise in its place, all of a sudden, there was a shift from taking out Assad to helping Assad by fighting ISIS. So in that sense, I would say it's not been very effective or justified. With that said, if we just focus on Trump, I would say I would agree that candidate Trump's policy regarding Syria was very effective in letting Russia help take out ISIS. ISIS fighters, I agree with that policy, and that's about the best we can hope for. And if we were to intervene in Syria, it should be, at this point, it should be to help Assad, just because, you know, Assad does not seem to have any plans for world domination, whereas ISIS very much does. And so ISIS is clearly the bigger threat in that sense. And while we don't necessarily need to defeat them, we should at least, you know, keep a thumb on them to make sure they don't grow or expand, because if they do, it won't just be a horrendous for the Middle East, but it could potentially be a world stabilizing process if ISIS keeps gaining territory. Then that's all I have to say.
Awesome. Fritz, how would you answer the question, is our policy in Syria justified or effective?
I mean, I think the problem is that, you know, I thought that originally the Trump that I voted for, candidate Trump, his foreign policy would have been essentially, you know, to take a step back from Syria and not intervene to destroy Assad's regime. I mean, certainly to destroy ISIS, I think, is justified, absolutely. But this whole sort of abrupt 180, and again, I like when you said schizophrenic, is deeply troubling, because, I mean, I thought that we were done with it, because I'm vehemently opposed to sort of neoconservative foreign policy, because I think I see it as very, very ineffective. But anyways, I think that if the current policy right now, with an idea of Assad must go, that's, first off, really naive, and it's an ineffectual policy that's going to make everything way worse, because I think we should have learned after Iraq and Libya that when you get rid of these dictators, who certainly are terrible, they're terrible people, when you get rid of them, things become 100 times worse. And yeah, I think right now what we need to do is not intervene in the middle in Syria outside of destroying ISIS and doing what we can to protect, you know, religious minorities like the Christians and the Yazidis and Shiites in Syria and Iraq. So I don't think that this new this idea of striking Syria and trying to get rid of Assad is justified or effective. And I think that I think that the reason why, my best guess as to why Donald Trump would do this is that because Obama got so much flack and it damaged his reputation so much when he said, you know, there's a line in the sand that Assad's is not allowed to cross, then Assad did it and Obama did nothing. Trump did not want to appear weak on the world stage and be seen as making the same mistakes Obama did. So perhaps this might just be an ego thing, which is fairly disturbing that on the idea of ego and reputation, the president is allowed to order missile strikes that kill people. And that's my piece.
Okay, great. So I guess at the end of all of the guests' contributions, I'll just sort of unleash my own opinion on the matter. I think there is has been a large debate in American foreign policy circles over who is the greater threat, ISIS or Assad. And, you know, of course, the neoconservatives think that Assad is a monster that needs to be taken out for the sake of world stability, and pretty much everyone else thinks ISIS is. But I happen to think that there's a third opinion in this. I don't think that there is anything more dangerous to the United States' long-term stability than this conflict itself. From the beginning to the end of this entire conflict has been one exhibition on American incompetence, American ineffectiveness, and this threatens to play the same role in American hegemonic decline that the Suez Crisis played in Britain's ultimate imperial decline. This could be the one instance where America demonstrates to the world that it is totally incapable of handling any situation, and any pretense that it could actually create stability in the world is totally ineffectual. Just to contrast our role with Russia. Russia has had one consistent position in this entire conflict, and that has been that Assad needs to stay for the sake of stability. America has had all of four positions. First, it is Assad has to go, the Syrian army has to replace him. The second one is, Assad has to just fight things out with no support on the Syrian rebel side, as long as he doesn't use chemical weapons. Then it is, maybe we'll take out Assad. Next is, ISIS is worse. Back and forth, no coherency. And I think this has created the stability that's really it's engulfed the world in conflict. It's made everything less stable. It's made all powers less sure of where they stand. And it's, no one's mentioned this yet, but it's basically it's flooded Europe with refugees that potentially destabilizes Europe, NATO, every single ally we have in the West. I mean, this conflict is doing more damage than ISIS ever will. But that's my take. So I guess any questions? So now we're going to go to an open discussion format. I'm going to moderate this, but I'm actually thinking that we might want to try just a general discussion. Does anyone want to start off with a question?
Sure. I have a thought on or question is, is there any, what is the level of knowledge we have of the various Syrian rebel groups as to how reliable and how, is there actually a sort of plan in place? Question is that Assad needs to go, who replaces him? Like, how much do we actually know about
the Syrian? To my knowledge, our knowledge of the Free Syrian Army is incredibly limited.
Mm-hmm. Well,
does anyone else have any other insights on that?
I kind of know the answer to that question, and I would. The answer is probably what you'd expect. It depends on the group, right? The rebels are not actually a coherent force. They're hundreds, maybe. They're definitely hundreds. They're not thousands, but they're hundreds of separate entities. Some are larger than others. The FSA is a big one, but it's not the main one. I think the big one in the north right now that's doing the most fighting is I think it's Jabhat al-Sham or something, and it's basically some al-Nusra guys or basically al-Qaeda guys that decided to leave al-Qaeda because Al-Qaeda was too extreme for them. And then they went and formed a sort of a coalition and then grew together with some random brigades, just some smaller entities. And they're mainly active in the southern part of that northern rebel area. That's the one that's most active right now. The largest one is still, I think, the FSA. And they're around the south, and they're pretty much everywhere.
Sure, but do you think, would any of these parties have a potential of replacing Assad? My instinct is no, right?
Or that any of them would be a...
If people start talking of each other, I'm muting people. So who would like to talk, please text me. Okay. I'm seeing Fritz. So, okay. So what was that, Fritz?
I think the bigger question is that, you know, would any of these people were Assad to fall, is there enough knowledge about any of them that they would possibly be a suitable replacement that would bring Syria, turn Syria into a more democratic or stable state? And I don't think that's the case at all, but do you guys have any knowledge on this?
Well, I can unmute people. Yes. Blackjack?
Okay, so as far as what the main rebel groups would do if Assad magically fell tomorrow, I think probably it would be either, you know, they would start fighting amongst themselves. Basically, Syria would devolve into a Somalia-like state, or it would depend on which group actually came into power. It could range from a sort of Iran-like democracy to another dictator like Assad.
Jared, did you have something to say?
No, that was just my main point. I just wanted to put that out there. It's not really a coherent thing, just my little snippet.
I mean, it certainly seems that Recep Erdogan seems to know what will happen when Assad falls. He seems to have all his chips on the fact that Assad is a temporary figure in the region.
I don't know what Erdogan's long-term play is. I mean, he can't really be friends with the Arabs or the Russians because they all hate him. And he can't really be friends with the Europeans because they all despise him now that he's been sending in all these migrants. So I want to see what his long-term plan is for global...
Because of a recent deal, Turkey's agreed to start, blocking a large number of the migrants from coming in.
But it already happened.
Yeah, I mean, what Turkey is doing now is using this as a bargaining chip to benefit them, because now they have the their fingers on the button of let more migrants in. Sorry, most of them are not refugees, and they can now essentially extort Europe.
Well, blackmail can only get you so far.
Blackjack, did you have an answer to that question?
Yes, I do know what Erdogan's plan is. His plan. What he wants basically is to set up a puppet regime in Syria. That's why he wants Assad to fall so much. That's why he made his own little rebel enclave in the far north of Syria on the border with Turkey. The reason for this is basically oil. He wants to get a pipeline from the Gulf states through Syria. I mean, you know, again, I don't know if you want me to go into this, but this is the main reason why all of these...
He's intent on undoing the work of T. Lawrence, right? From Lawrence of Arabia. Erdogan's the anti-Lawrence of Arabia.
He wants to make the Ottoman Empire great again.
He does. that is exactly his plan. He wants to make the Ottoman Empire great again.
I've thought a lot about this. I mean, it seems a little bit a stretch, though, because if Erdogan has a plan to sort of put the region under his control, it leads me to believe that things are a lot less
realistic. A
lot less chaotic than you might think otherwise, right? I mean, you think this is just insane, Blackjack?
Erdogan's plan is insane? Yes. Yes, Erdogan is insane.
I think there may be a grain of reasonability to Erdogan's plan, because one thing, I'll be mentioned Dictator's Handbook more in the future, but one thing that they point out that helped the U.S. founding fathers create a non-oppressive regime was the need for support from a lot of people. I suspect that would be the case, because to maintain some kind of stability in Syria, Erdogan wouldn't just need, you know, just one or two regimes to back him. He'd need to find 50 rebel groups that would be in favor of him, which is gives him a lot of key supporters, which inherently makes a society more stable and better for everyone on average.
I should ask the question, what do people think? And this, I want to ask this one at a time. So I guess I'll start with Blackjack, because you seem like you have an opinion on this. What do you think that for, like, our objective should be? I mean, is it a sad victory? I mean, it seems to me like it is.
Okay, so what I think our objective should be is to mainly, number one is to limit Iranian influence in Syria. That's the main thing. That's, you know.
Is that really the main thing? I'm going to push back. That's what everyone says in the foreign policy establishment. But
yeah, I know.
If Assad wins, Iranian influence is going to be more than if Assad loses. But to my mind, Assad winning, the world looks much better for the United States than Assad losing. And this whole thing falling in a heap. Iranian influence grows.
Well, I don't think that they're mutually exclusive. I think that you can have some combination of Assad winning and Iran losing. And Russia would be the key to that. But again, I don't know what the actual plan is.
I mean, Iran, I would point out here that isn't Iran one of Assad's main allies?
Yes, Iran is one of Assad's main allies. But, you know,
okay,
things can change.
I mean,
I'll pass the question to you, Fritz. What do you think?
I mean, if I could just address that first, Assad is Alawite part of Shiite Islam?
Yes.
Yeah. I don't see the alliance between Iran and Syria as, I almost think you could, it could be used to an advantage, because it could be used to counter both Saudi power and Turkish power in the region, to prevent them from one of them from becoming a hegemon in the Middle East. But I think our policy should be to, outside of getting rid of ISIS, not be involved with the Syrian civil war, if not just aid Assad in helping to end the war as quickly as we possibly can.
Blackjack, did you have something to say?
Yeah, as far as Fritz's concern about Saudi and Turkish influence in the Middle East, Saudi influence isn't that much of a threat to global stability. The entities within Saudi Arabia themselves might be, but as far as the Saudi government goes, they're relatively peaceful. They don't have any outside of their own internal security, they don't have any concerns.
Don't they fund a lot of terrorist organizations, though?
Well, yes, entities within Saudi Arabia do, but the Saudi government itself is not as expansion. Iran is much more of a regional threat and has acted as such within the Middle East than Saudi Arabia has ever done.
But can you explain to me why the Iranian influence thing is such a bugbear, I guess? Like,
okay,
this is what I'm sort of missing. I understand that they're sort of a legacy opponent of the United States, but I'm not so sure. I mean, given that they're the largest country in that region by far, their hegemonic dominance to some degree is more or less assured. We're really only talking about degrees, right?
Yeah, and I'm saying that should be well. Okay, so a lot of the things that Iran does that makes it dangerous is, primarily, it funds terrorism all over the place. I mean, it destabilized it dis, destabilized Yemen pretty much all by itself. It's funding rebels within Saudi Arabia also. It's threatening to destabilize Saudi Arabia. Before this, and even now still, it uses Iraq as a sort of puppet, Syria as well. And this causes a lot of tension within those countries that basically culminated in ISIS.
So, sure. So I'm gonna since I asked Blackjack and Fritz what they thought the end of the ultimate end of American foreign policy for this particular conflict should be, to close out this question, I'm going to ask the same for everybody else, starting with Pius, and then we'll move on to the next question.
So I honestly think the end of the American foreign policy in Syria would probably be, I think we want to leave Assad with the most power. I don't think we want to, like, you know, totally destroy any one faction, but I think we want to try to at least leave Assad with the biggest stick, so to say, in the region. I think we want him to have the most power because he's probably the least threatening to America overall. Because he'll definitely help us with dismantling ISIS and other Islamic groups. But at the same time, I don't want us to look like we're favoring one country over another, if that makes sense.
Okay. Anarcho?
So I'd say we allow these two groups, Assad and ISIS, to continue to butcher each other and only intervene to prevent the worst threat, which is ISIS, from spreading. I hate Assad, but we need him in power because at this point he's the lesser evil.
Jared?
I'd say if we were to impose a settlement, which seems difficult to say the least, given all the players at the table, it would have to be a guaranteed Ba'athist or Alawite presidency with basically a federal government for the Alawites and the Druze and the Assyrians and the Sunnis and the Kurds, all of their own little autonomous enclaves with possibly like regional militias. But it just all seems like such a quagmire now that it's not going to be solved until one group slaughters the rest.
Josh?
I think there's two realistic things. One would be a federalization, sort of, just because there are so many different groups competing for power. I think that's probably the best one. And then possibly like mixing that with like a set, like sort of a three-state solution type of thing, where you know, the Kurds, Assad, and then the federalization. Sort of like a Swiss Federation type of thing of all the rebel groups. And so between the three of them, they can sort out how they want to deal with ISIS. And, you know, if they decide to go at each other's throats again, then we can intervene. That's a potential future problem that I can't predict with certainty.
Okay. And to finish out this particular question, I am just going to say, this war needs to end. And it looks like Assad is the only person that can end it. We've tried everything. This is the only solution. So it's not very romantic, but I think Assad is really the only person that can stay there, as terrible of a person as he is. So I'm going to go on to question number two right now. And I'm just going to build it up. So this question we have over Syria is not some isolated thing. The United States has been dealing with Middle Eastern problems for 40 years now. Pretty much since 1968, the region's been one huge area of turmoil and ceaseless crisis. And no foreign policy we've implemented has really been able to take that on. So I think that really when we talk about what needs to be done about Syria, the question is, what needs to be done about the Middle East? Is it just going to be playing whack-a-mole? Syria civil war ends, another civil war pops up in Lebanon, pops up in Algeria, pops up in Egypt. So I think at this point we'll start with Fritz. What do you think should be done about the larger Middle East question when it comes to American foreign policy?
I think what we need to do is, after we get rid of ISIS, we need to pull out I think that it may sound defeatist, but the fact is that it seems every time, the more we intervene, the more we keep messing things up. Like, we keep, we're constantly just trying to correct the mistakes that we already made. I mean, I think on a humanitarian level and a diplomatic level, I think it would be useful to maintain guarantee of independence of Israel. And I think to we should do what we can to protect the Christians in the Middle East. But I think that continued intervention in the Middle East is only going to lead to this happening again and again and again. It's never going to end so long as the Middle East it stays the sandbox for major powers to play in, and the native populations there forming terrorist groups in part response to this. So yeah, I think we need to get out of the Middle East.
Jared?
I am gonna second Blackjack here that isolationism does not work. I don't think we can really get out of the Middle East when the Mideast has come here. And despite all the complaints the jihadists have about American imperialism, I'd say their problem has much more to do with modernity itself. And therefore they're gonna keep going after the decadent West, whether we have troops stationed there or not. And I think Syria is a good example of what happens when Americans aren't on the ground, because Iraq, really, after the surge, was pretty stable until Obama abandoned the place. And if we look at Syria, it's a country with half the population of Iraq. It's experienced twice as many dead people in a shorter span of time and a much more unstable place, with the Russians and the Iranians and the Turks and even the Israelis to a limited extent involved.
Josh?
What exactly is the question?
What do you think, how do you think America should approach foreign policy in the Middle East?
Oh, so this is round two.
More generally, yes.
Okay. I think this is kind of be poking at round three a little bit. One of the things that we notice in history is that democracies don't go to war with other democracies, or generally they're even less likely to go to war, and dictatorships lose wars. So I don't think we should do the 2002, 2003 George Bush, let's go spread freedom everywhere, just because we know that hasn't worked. I think our MO should be waiting until a dictatorship does start a war, and then using that opportunity to collapse the dictatorship in hopes of potentially creating something better out of it. And it is risky. It's one of the archetypal sort of stories is you have to go from a bad place to a worse place before you can get to a better place. Sometimes you fail, but because we have power, we being US as a collective, we can try, and I would say we're, to an extent, we need to try just to wait until, one dictatorship declares war on a non-dictatorship, then try to pressure that, use that situation to create more democracy.
Cool. Blackjack?
So U.S. Middle East policy in general, I think, should have a couple of rules. You stick with the people you've chosen to support. Like for us, it's Saudi Arabia. They may be terrible in many respects, but we have chosen to support them. And I think that we should definitely do as much as we can to improve the situation in Saudi Arabia for the people there. But for better or worse, there are guys in the area. So we ought to stick by them. I think that Josh, if that's it, yes, it is. Josh had a very good idea as far as how to respond to aggressive dictatorships in the region. I think that not finishing off Assad in 91 was a mistake, but you live and learn. I think generally the third rule is that if you have to choose between stability and democracy, I would say you choose stability. So like if you have a dictator in power in a region, but he's, you know, keeping it stable. Yes, I meant Saddam. I don't know what I said. What did I say? Did I say Assad? I did.
I meant
Saddam. Yeah, Jared got me off track. Where was I? Forgot where I was.
Let's keep on and just finish your response to the question. What should American foreign policy be in the Middle
East? Yeah, right. That's where I was. I think, in general, you know, you would choose stability. You would choose to work with a stable dictator over just overthrowing him for no reason. I think the serious situation in specific, it would take me too long to go into that. And I think the third or the fourth and probably final rule is that whatever you can do to limit Iranian influence should be done. Until they can have proven themselves, you know, until they prove that they can act in the region without, you know, basically trying to turn the whole place on its head again. That's as far as I'll go with that.
Okay, great. Pius?
Okay, so to keep from completely echoing Fritz, I pretty much agree with what he said, that we need to get out of Middle East as soon as we can, because we've really screwed that place up enough, I think. But I think we should, for the most part, I think we should get Assad at least somewhat stable in the Middle East and then work with him to defeat ISIS and then pull out, because I think we've done enough harm in the general area for the most part. I think we should back out, let things play their course after we get rid of ISIS, and then we should stay away until, you know, unless something else happens.
Okay, great. And is that it?
No, I got...
sorry, Narco, I apologize. Go ahead.
No, it's all right. So the way I see it, I second Fritz's call for non-interventionism. The Mideast, as far as I can see, is just a black hole for peace and prosperity, and will stay that way for a long time, as long as Islam is the dominant hegemonic ideology in that region. I see all of those countries completely irresistant to, you know, change and more democratic and liberal pressures, as long as Islam stays in control of politics and culture. With that said, I say military intervention is useless. It's not going to bring about any positive results, because all we'll be doing is supporting another Islamic tyrant over another, which is the best case scenario. And then the worst case scenario is just anarchy, which, as an anarcho-rain, I shouldn't mind that much. But anyway, we should pull out all military support, and what we can do is sanction any countries that are acting really terribly. Like, for instance, Saudi Arabia is bombing Yemen into a crater. We should probably sanction them, try to cut off oil ties from them. You should probably sanction Israel's actions against Palestine. And what if we were to pursue a policy in the Middle East, and I would recommend we do this diplomatically, not militarily, we should try to pursue a policy of nationalism, of pan-nationalism. For instance, I would separate Iraq into three different sections. You know, I would try to give the Kurds their own state, because they seem to have an organic bond, you know, whereas most of the borders in that region were just drawn up by imperial powers. Same with Israel. Diplomatically, I would push as hard for the two-state solution and take, as I said, punitive measures against, you know, Israel if they do not bow into those demands. Same with other countries that try to interfere with that, because that's the best we can do, trying to military intervene. I agree with, I believe it was, I forget who said that, you know, as long as once the U.S. left Iraq, it fell into disarray. That's true. That's absolutely true. But it's inevitable. And unless we want to occupy these countries forever, I say we just, you know, pull off the Band-Aid now and, you know, let the anarchy resume, and hopefully it resolves itself as quickly as possible.
All right. So I guess it only leaves me. So I think I might take a middle ground on this one. I don't like intervention. I think it's particularly futile in the Middle East for accomplishing humanitarian goals. But I will point out this. There's no way you can not intervene. And for the people who are strictly isolationists, I'll just pose this question. War isn't going to stop if the United States moves out of the Middle East. It's perfectly likely that Russia and Turkey will go to war over Iraq and Syria. It's perfectly possible that Turkey and Iran might go to war over Mesopotamia. What happens when those two countries tear apart that region, and then you have 3 million migrants show up on the door of Europe? Is America isolated from that? Doesn't seem like it's possible. So I guess with that little tidbit, I'll just throw the door open for questions. Anyone have questions? Or
okay, can I
guess I should just respond to that question that I threw out there to the isolationists.
All right. So I would say in terms of Russia and Turkey going to war over Iraq, I was waiting for the part where that concerns us. I guess you could say that since it will destabilize the world in general.
That concerns us when we have 3 million migrants show up on Europe's doorstep, which will happen.
Well, that's not just because there are more people who need shelter doesn't mean that we just have to throw our doors open to them. This is, you know, there are millions of people who always want to go to the West, you know, even war or no war. Why should the fact that, oh, now there's a war, now we have to take them? I'm just not seeing the logical connection of, oh, you're right, now that they're refugees.
What if you do not have Turkey as a stopgap to potential migrant flow, which the scenario I laid out would preclude you from having this, this would involve developing a massive protective layer around Southern Europe, which we do not have currently. But I don't want to dominate this conversation. Anyone else have a question or a response?
Yeah, I mean, my response to this is that, like, you know, that all that certainly the case, but I think that American intervention only makes things worse. We're just we seem to be just another country intervening. Hillary Clinton's foreign policy in Libya is directly responsible for much of the migrant crisis. So I don't understand why having another major world power getting involved in the Middle East would actually solve anything.
Agreed.
Pius?
So I wanted to ask, so what do you think we should do about the religious minorities that are suffering because of all this Islamic infighting? Should we protect them like America? Should America protect them? Should we leave them to their fate? Or should we, like, just in general, is there anything we should do at all?
That question is directed at me.
Anybody who wants to chime in.
This is the difficult thing. It's like, absolutely, I think we should have sort of response. We should... I'm not very much in favor. I'll get to this into the third question. But I do think that when there is a genocide, when there is an undergoing, effort to wipe out a certain group of people, you know, be it Christians or Yazidis or whatever, I think countries do have a responsibility to have a moral duty to do what they can to help them. And I think that I don't rightly know what we should do. Should we, you know, push for creating a state for these people? Should we, allow them to, should we just, you know, say that, throw our doors open to them and say any, you know, religious minorities can come to the West and start a new life here? I'm not sure what the best policy for that is, but I think that we should have an obligation to help these people.
I agree.
Blackjack?
Yep. I'm here. Okay. So, as far as my isolationist friends go, they don't seem to be entirely isolationists, in the purest sense. And I'm fine with that. But I do kind of wonder what is the difference between religious minorities in the Middle East and the people who are followers of Islam themselves? Why are their lives, the people, the lives of religious minorities' lives, more valuable than the lives of the Muslims?
Because they're the ones being directly targeted for their for not being Sunni Muslims.
Not only that, but they're not even involved in the conflict for the most part, and they're kind of suffering at the hands of others for something.
But hold on, I have a question here. I mean, we're acting like, I mean, if this foreign policy, if you're going to write into foreign policy that Christians are innocent, but all Muslims in the Middle East aren't. I mean, like, there's a certain reality of modern Western foreign policy. Like, I mean, it seems that you're fiating sort of a conversation that just could not be had in the West right now, which is that we're going to collectively associate Sunni Muslims with being the party at fault in the Middle East, and therefore systematically deny them access to a refugee policy that would ordinarily be granted to them if they were another religion. Is that what you're proposing?
No, I mean, all I'm saying is that, I mean, I think we should help the religious minorities, and I think trying to justify the reason why is why them over the ordinary Sunni Muslims is because the regular, yeah, certainly the regular Sunni Muslims, many of them are, you know, they are being, of course, they're being caught in the fighting, and large number of civilians, you know, the civilians, by nature being civilians, aren't responsible for the fighting. But again, the fact is that Christians and other religious minorities are the ones being directly targeted for extermination and genocide by groups like ISIS.
But I'm saying that will not be, you won't be able to say that definitively when you craft policy.
I know. I mean, I'm not here to say that. I'm not an expert on foreign policy. So,
if I'm not
anyway, I should go ahead. Okay, Pius, and then Jared.
I was just going to say, if I'm not mistaken, I actually think that when Poland did their sort of migrant policy, I think they were the way they set theirs up is that they were only going to let Christians in to their nation, and not Islamic migrants.
Jared.
Well, as far as the problem of discrimination goes, I'd respond that the whole point of asylum is to protect those who are most vulnerable during the conflict, which is definitely the religious minorities. And I'd say Syrian Christians are a lot less likely to cause long-term societal problems, and that they're more likely to assimilate than your Syrian Muslims are. So that's just my two cents.
Blackjack? Blackjack.
Okay. I thought my microphone was off. Yeah. So my main problem with all of this is that I'm fine with protecting. I as a general rule, I would like to protect all life, all human life in the Middle East in general. But I don't see why we should make. Why we shouldn't just try to make the Middle East a more peaceful place instead of just, you know, letting, first off, you know, giving these people basically a choice between live in this crazy anarchic land or move away from your homes, the homes that your people have lived on for thousands of years. I don't see why we should offer them this choice. I don't see why, because we can do it. It is possible to make the Middle East more peaceful. I don't see why we shouldn't just try to do that instead.
Okay, because
it doesn't work.
Yeah, I oppose a question that actually fits perfectly with what Blackjack just said. Blackjack just asked, you know, why can't we try to make the Middle East more peaceful? I would ask, how possible is that while Islam, as I brought up in my response to the question, with Islam still being the hegemonic force in the Middle East, how possible is peace really when you have an imperialist political religious ideology that dominates your culture?
Blackjack, do you want to respond to that? Yeah, go ahead. If someone directly asks you a question,
I will answer. Okay. Yeah. So I guess that works. I would respond to that by saying that it is possible because it's been done before. If I mean I know this isn't exactly the best Well, actually, there are two, but I'll go with the colonialism first. I mean, if you look at the colonial rule, aside from that, the instances of Muslim and Jewish rights in Palestine, it was by and large mostly peaceful over the time that it was in mostly Muslim areas. I mean, it honestly, a lot of this didn't really start until the 70s, because before that, it was mostly secular dictatorships in the Middle East, and they were relatively peaceful, aside from those few occasions where they all ganged up on Israel. So, you know, to say that it's impossible is not true, because the Middle East was once very secular. This radicalization of Islam is only a fairly recent... I mean, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood wasn't founded until, I think, the 70s.
It was earlier than that, but it was 50s. Jared, I think he texted me. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, there were lots of secular terrorists, like the guys who murdered all the Israelis in Munich were a bunch of secularists. And can go.
Anarcho?
So Blackjack, you said it was most peaceful under imperial rule, I think I heard you say. Is that correct?
No, it was peaceful under the imperial rule. It was also peaceful under the secular dictators.
And the Ottomans.
And the Ottomans.
Right, so
I classify the Ottomans as imperial, but...
I guess my question is... first, why do you think the secular dictators were able to... first off, why aren't the secular dictators still in power, I guess, would be my first question. Like, how
why aren't the secular...
Yeah, like, why has, radical Islam, what I just call Islam, why was that, take power in the first place? Like, why did Iran become a radical Shia state, for instance?
Well, that was mostly response to what it saw as foreign influence.
I didn't hear an answer to the question. What was the answer?
I was working on the answer, but I was having some trouble getting enough air out of my face.
Well, you basically said it, foreign intervention.
Well, no, that's only part of it. But I mean, if you want to go with that, fine.
I'd say it's
if you're trying to make a point, then I'll let you keep going with that.
I mean, I would just say that when we replaced their dictator, Iran's dictator, for reasons related to oil, that's what allowed the who took power after the secular
regime? Ayatollah Khomeini.
That was largely a response due to U.S. intervention.
And UK intervention.
Granted, that particular intervention may not have been the most noblest, though I have a very skeptical view of U.S. foreign policy in general. I don't see it as having very noble reasons for intervening in general. But, it was U.S. foreign intervention that at least destabilized Iran, and Iran's not, that's not a story that's very different from what you see with a lot of Middle Eastern countries. I have to agree with Fritz that it just seems that the U.S. and the West in general seems to be doing more harm than good by trying to impose peace in these countries.
But Anarcho, if you're right about Islam being as imperialistic and expansionistic as you alluded to, why would you think that American imperialism would be necessary or American intervention would be necessary? Wouldn't you expect these Wouldn't you expect these revolutions to erupt spontaneously just out of the ideology and culture?
No. Oh, okay, I see what you're saying. So I think you need the reason the Middle East has been uniquely destabilized. We've seen and the two reasons are Islam and U.S. interventionism together.
Islam would not do it independent. Islam would be stable and peaceful, independent of America.
Is Indonesia as radical as any of the countries you see in the Middle East. They have, the people there have some pretty radical views regarding, you know, Sharia law and, you know, how to treat, and, you know, on basic human rights. They have very horrendous views informed by their Islamic faith, but they're not as radical as what we see in these Middle Eastern countries because they
but
don't
America
have a foreign
it.
Power.
I just say America don't... intervened in Indonesia, though.
Yeah.
Have we, for
Indonesia
how,
is actually about
extent?
As radical as
that's
Saudi Arabia.
I mean, it's an attitude.
Hold on, hold on.
Because...
intervening is very vague because we've intervened in almost, this is going to go to the third question, but we've all intervened in almost every single country on Earth. So it's not just, you know, just simply doing an invasion once, you know, and then leaving as we've done with certain countries. That's not the same as continued and sustained intervention, as has been the case with Iraq, as has been the case with, you know, with supporting, you know, Israel, with Palestine. That's what gives these certain groups the ability to say, oh, look, that foreign power over there is a great threat to us. You know, and going back to what I was saying about intervening in all these countries, the reason other nations have not, at least not all of them, have, you know, fallen into complete disarray is because, you know, they don't have the Islamic influence. You know, that we intervene in Buddhist countries, we're not necessarily going to see the same response as we do with, you know, an imperialist political religious ideology.
It's Islam and intervention together that cause these reactions.
You need the two key. You need the two together, or else, in order to have the complete, you know, chaos that that is the Middle East today. Anyone else?
No, I think Gennarco got it. I mean, I think
I agree.
Every time we keep intervening in the Middle East, things seem to just get worse. I mean, we can do. I mean, the thing is, I do. I do agree that we can.
What?
Distributist. Yeah, you guys. Please stop muting me, distributist.
What's going on?
I keep getting muted.
Okay.
That's distributist, if you're trying to say something or take over or to direct the conversation, we can't hear you.
Hello?
Sorry, guys. I apologize. Looks like my mic just stopped working. Jared, did you have something to say?
I thought I was going first.
No, look, Fritz, I was trying to let Jared have a chance to speak because he was texting me, but apparently my microphone cut out or something. Jared, go ahead.
I really think the effect of these interventions in radicalizing the Muslims is vastly overstated. Like, the modern Islamic movement was much more a response to the Nasserism and Ba'athism that was secularizing society and the Arab Cold War than it had to do with the Western influence. Like, Sayyid Qutb and all those founders of modern Islamic thought in Egypt were much more opponents of Nasser and Sadat than they were of the British.
But wouldn't you just say that there was a brief, I mean, to me it looks more, if I were to look at Islam as a history, it would look like basically theocracy with this little blip of secularism and then back to theocratic motivations. I mean, I think that you can say certainly that the Qutb and all of these other Islamists in the 50s were a response to secularists, but the secularists like Nasser and Ataturk, these were unique phenomenons or more or less unique phenomenons in the early 20th century. They never had any precedent before or since.
I would agree with that. I'm imposing a modern, like Western style liberal democracy in the Middle East does not seem particularly viable. I think a sort of like a Islamic democracy with like limited Sharia that's very watered down with elections and pluralism, like what they're trying to do in Tunisia, is much more viable in the long term for how to solve a lot of the Middle East's problems.
Okay, Fritz, do you want to take a response now, and then we can go on to the last question?
Sure. Yeah, I think I was just going to say is that I think that if we're going to look at things a political reality, that do I think that we could stabilize the Middle East? Like, somebody pointed out that after the troop surge in Iraq, that things got stable. But the thing is, it seems like then it would require years, if not decades, of heavy military occupation. That's something that the American people are just not going to. That's just not going to fly with the American people. After years in Iraq and Afghanistan, we are not. Our country is not. Does not want to do what it would take to stabilize these countries.
Does anyone have any responses before we go on to the last question?
I would say that's what we did in Germany and Korea. And I mean, long-term occupation does not mean like 150,000 people for 50 years. It maybe means like 5 or 10,000 people just as a presence to keep the government toeing the line and keeping them from doing anything crazy. Just providing stability.
I mean, I still don't. I mean, again, what happened, the situation of Iraq versus what happened in Germany is very different. And I still think that right now there's not the political capital or political will of the American people to send even a modest amount of U.S. troops to occupy a territory in the Middle East.
I agree. I think we lack the morale to really do something like that.
Mm-hmm. And with good reason, because of the sort of disaster we had in Iraq.
Black Deck, do you want to have the final response before we go on to the last question?
Yeah, I will just say that, actually, at least the way I see it, Germany and Iraq, after both regimes respectively were toppled, were very similar. I would say that the only difference is that the way we managed Iraq was magnitudes of order worse than the way we managed Germany after the war. I would say that de-bathification, we got rid of, first, not only did we basically ban all qualified Sunni Arab Muslims from serving in any kind of government or high military post, but also a lot of those people were the ones who actually had experience, who actually knew their jobs. We didn't do that in Germany, at least immediately. You know, we at least had them train their successors. I would say there are some differences. They're not exactly the same. You know, Germany was not as sectarianly divided or was not as divided in general as Iraq was. But still, despite that, the similarities do remain. And I would say that Iraq was original. In the end, I think Iraq probably could have ended up being a relatively stable kind of country. I think that probably installing a democracy the way it was would have probably led to it being a Shia puppet of Iran anyway. But okay. I think,
okay,
again, that I'll have to end here because
yes, I'll let's go on, going on. Let's go on to the last question. So the last question is just a general statement about what you think U.S. foreign policy should be broadly in the world. How should the U.S. impose its hegemony? This has been a topic that's been really something that's been a hot issue since the end of World War II, since the United States effectively became the primary world power. But I think a lot of people now are considering that a change is needed. So the question I think is, I consider Syria a turning point. Given that Syria might indeed be a turning point for U.S. foreign policy, going forward, what do you think United States foreign policy should generally be? Are there rules, Anarcho?
Okay, so as I alluded to in the last round, the U.S. has been involved and invaded almost every single country on Earth. We've pretty much been the de facto one world policeman. And my main thought is, if you want the one world police, and I'm not, you know, necessarily opposed to that, depending on the structure of it, set up the one world government. But America cannot be that one world government. The American people never agreed to that. We're not obligated to pay for the one world police. And the idea that one country has it on its shoulders to establish the principles of liberty, democracy throughout the world, which it will enforce, you know, whether they want it or not. It's a contradiction as well as an unreasonable goal. And it's just not, as a nationalist, I feel governments should be focused on protecting and serving their people, not just any people that we feel would benefit from our Western values. You know, but the Western values, it has to come internally. It has to be each country, the people make a change to say, you know, we don't want this dictator. We don't want dictators in general. We don't want authoritarianism. We like what the West is doing. We like what they're doing with civil liberties and you know, certain political systems, republics. We want to copy that, and we want nothing to do with Islam. We basically have to wait for that to develop internally, and you know, and maybe foster it diplomatically, you know, only. And as for military interventionism, what it should be, when you see something like ISIS or Hitler threatening world domination, threatening plans to take the entire world under their rule, you pretty much have to rally up the troops and send something to try to contain the threat before it gets really bad. And at genocides, perhaps there's a case to be made that very, perhaps defense of these groups plus relocation to a better place, not necessarily in our borders, but somewhere, would be the best thing to do under those circumstances. But that's what I would do, and military intervention, global intervention, has been a failure. Let's end it as soon as possible. Kill the American Empire. Next.
Okay. Fritz?
I do agree a lot with Anarcho. I think actually, though, Distributus, America's history of intervention in foreign affairs, I mean, on the world stage, started in the early 20th century, starting with interventions in China in after the Boxer Rebellion, and even in 1898 with the Spanish-American War, which was completely unjustified. But the big thing was World War One, in which we more or less helped create the monster that was Nazi Germany by intervening in the First World War, because we may have not liked Imperial Germany, but they were a hell of a lot better than what was going to follow in the wake of their destruction. But following that, it seems that the American century has been a century of unmitigated bloodshed and war, and we have probably done I almost think of it like this, is that when Woodrow Wilson says we need to make the world safe for democracy, it almost feels like, looking at this 100 years later, we need to save the world from quote-unquote democracy, i.e. American imperialism invading every country that seems to cross our path that we don't like. So, in short, I think our foreign policy should be nationalism, should be what benefits the American people. We should only engage in alliances and relations with other countries when it benefits us and when they more or less share our values. So a country like maybe Japan or the United Kingdom. But I think we should go back to generally a policy what the founding fathers did, which was, you know, commerce and friendship with all nations, alliance with none, and we need to stop intervening in other countries' affairs. Because every time we do, it seems to make things a million times worse.
Jared?
So yeah, again, no more American Empire.
Jared?
I'd say the American Empire, as the Buchananites like to call it, has had a much more positive effect on the world than anarchy or Fritz believe. I mean, we spent most of the 20th century keeping the commies at bay. And I think you guys would not say that the world would be better off if we had just let them swallow up most of Asia and Europe and Africa and Latin America. And for the America First criticism, I would say a stable world where countries are not invading each other or committing genocide is probably, on balance, better off for the United States economically, where we can trade with people and we're less likely to have, you know, airliners blown into like skyscrapers. And I'd say that the world is better off when we are the guarantors of national borders. And when we pull out of the Middle East, when we get ISIS, we pull out of Eastern Europe, we get a war in Ukraine and Georgia. We pull out of East Asia, we get tensions in the South China Sea. So, I mean, if we leave, someone's going to fill that vacuum. It's inevitably going to be much worse than us because the Europeans are just too inept to pick up the slack for us.
Josh?
Sorry, I had to unmute. Okay, so disclaimer, this might be a little bit of a winding path to explain why I'm in my position. So I think the first thing our foreign policy is dependent on is reducing the debt, because having a $20 trillion debt makes us very beholden to, you know, people wanting to buy our currency, and then they use it for buying oil and other stuff like that. I think if that number was a more manageable, like 5 or 10 trillion, we'd be much less beholden to, you know, dictators like Saudi Arabia and a lot of the major oil producing nations that want to destabilize. That's more of a Middle East aspect of it. But I think to a degree, debt, just having lots of debt, makes you a puppet to other forces, and you can't just start doing whatever you want. I think reducing debt is the first step. The second thing I think is the whole world, from what I've read, the whole world benefits from having something like the U.S. Go around to, you know, police, be the world police. I think that costs a lot. I think we should, you know, charge for it. I know it's kind of tiptoeing into a mercenary type of territory, but I think, you know, the NATO nations that are putting in 1 or 2% of their GDP, instead of the 5% they committed to, the whatever remainder should be sent towards the U.S. And, you know, if anyone else is pulling their weight, I think 2 or 3 other countries in NATO are pulling their weight. I think that's what it should look like militarily. Okay. But I think there's also another aspect of that, and that's, you know, looking at these people who are terrible, like Assad or Kim Jong-un, and looking at what their keys to power are. I know it's a very new development, but I really like what Trump and China are doing with North Korea. It seems like, you know, North Korea is getting cut out of the equation for coal, which was, from what I understand, is a big part of what helps keep the Kim family in power in North Korea. I think if we take, you know,
so can you summarize, so we don't get onto North Korea?
Yeah. Likewise, I've talked to you know, friends from Cuba who don't want U.S. tourism there because I'm trying to stabilize. Because it's used to, you know, line the pockets of the people who wish to do evil. I think sort of it has to be done on a nation by nation scale of looking at what makes evil people stay in power. And it's, you know, not religion. It's I mean, religion is one part of it, but I think what enables them to stay in power, and trying to cut that part of their power structure out from under them. Should be what the U.S. does, because I think that people who are strong, you know, should protect those who cannot protect themselves.
Great. Blackjack?
Okay. So I think Ronald Reagan probably rebutted my isolationist friends as far as world policy goes pretty well, some like 30 years ago. So I won't address that. What I will say is that generally U.S. foreign policy should look kind of like a communal police department. You know, we have allies in regions, and we work with them to help make that region more stable. So basically, we sort of assign specific countries, you know, security in certain areas. Like, for instance, France could be responsible for security in Northern Africa. And then when they get into too much trouble, we go help them out or something like that. I think that's what we should be trying to do. Try to make our allies more engaged in the process of keeping the world a stable and secure place. But I think that fundamentally, at the backbone of that system, should be the United States. We should come prepared. We should always be prepared, and we should come prepared to help out our allies whenever they get into, you know, too much stuff and they can't handle it. I think that should be fundamentally the way that we run U.S. foreign policy. I think that as far as interventions go, we should focus on stability, but we shouldn't completely rule out the idea of trying to establish new democracies. I think that is, again, I think we need to be more reasonable about that than we have been in places like Iraq. I think that Iraq was managed poorly again. I think that probably the best model for how we ought to run interventions in the future would be, or run stability operations in the future would be something like Japan or Germany. I think those were run beautifully, and I think we ought to try to relearn what we've forgotten after the 40s. I think that's about all I've had to say.
Great. Pius?
Okay, so I think that while I agree with Fritz and with Anarcho probably the most, I can see points that Blackjack and Jared and that they've made, and I can concede some ground to them that in certain areas, interventionism has worked. Like Japan, it worked there, and South Korea, it worked there. However, I think that the U.S. should stay out of the Middle East as far as things are concerned, because as long as Anarcho said, as long as Islam is in power in the Middle East, if we try to intervene, it's just going to make things worse. It's just going to make another firecracker go off. And I also think we should consider the fact that when a lot of Americans voted for Donald Trump, they expected a more isolationist approach to foreign policy. And I think that at least for now, we should respect that and try to keep the U.S. out of at least most wars as things, you know, as long as his presidency goes, whether or not he gets reelected is, you know, up for grabs. But I also would like to say that I think that there is a middle ground that can be taken here, that that there are certain places where isolationism should be highly favored, and that there are other places where interventionism has been successful. But as things stand right now, I must say I lean towards isolationism.
All right. I think that closes us out, doesn't it? Well,
Bruce, do you want to put your view up?
Yeah. I mean, I think largely I'd like to think that you could be some kind of friend to all, ally to none, simply participate in commerce. But at the end of the day, there are political and military spheres of influence. The question is, who's going to own them? And there's not going to be vacuums in these things. And so really what we're deciding is what order is going to rule the planet. A lot of this could be accomplished simply by making our allies pull their fair share. I think that something radical needs to happen. Some big change needs to come about, because what's going on right now is totally unsustainable. We can't continuously just be firing cruise missiles into random Middle Eastern countries. We can't be facing off every single regional power that wants to set up shop, you know, whether it's North Korea or Russia. It's an insane situation, and this role the United States is not going to have. I mean, what's going to come up in the meantime is anyone's guess. It's certainly not going to be some kind of Madisonian isolationism. But again, a big change is needed, so I'm open to hear things.
I mean, this is the thing, is that
it can't sustain itself. And the thing is, I don't want it to sustain itself in its current form, because the American modern Western civilization is not one that I am really all that in favor of, because it has abandoned Christianity, it's abandoned traditional values in favor of sort of rampant consumerist materialism and, you know, abortion.
Wait, are you saying your foreign policy is influenced by the state of the culture war?
I would say
in
that
some way. Yeah, I mean, I don't want to. I mean, if America and the West were, if this was a situation of like of 1900, when you had, you know, the hegemony of the world under the control of Western Christian nations, I'd look far more favorably upon that. But that's not what we have right now.
And that's.
I don't want an American-led world when the America is one which is, you know, which promotes a culture that is ultimately destructive to the people that inhabit it.
That's pretty radical. But, yeah, Anarcho, did you want to add to that?
Because, yeah, because the thing is, I would also, how's it going to look to the Muslims, you know, in these Middle Eastern countries on the ground? You know, I don't like Islam in general, but at least what I will give Islam is it at least is a bit more closer to my sort of traditionalist values than modernity. And how's it going to look when a nation that is inculcated with the sexual revolution and with all these changes to our culture that have unhinged all the socially conservative mores in our country, how's that going to look to them when we start dictating to them what their values ought to be? Clearly, they're not going to want to accept our influence when we are just inculcated in all of this liberalization.
But hold on. I think Fritz was saying something different, though. My impression was not simply that we shouldn't be nation building because of cultural because of the cultural revolution, but rather that the entire American sphere of influence should be contracted because of cultural revolution.
I mean, I certainly don't want to continue nation building on that, but I mean, in terms of our current sphere of influence, yeah, I mean, I don't like the idea that, you know, we have to push abortion rights onto abortion and gay marriage onto other countries, because I don't agree with either one of those things.
Well, how about this? Would you say that we should withdraw the naval divisions from Taiwan because of the culture war?
I would say, I think that is an area in which I do think that perhaps a certain amount of influence, because I think we can have a reasonable, like, I don't
well,
think...
Well, that's a large percentage of our mm-hmm. sphere of influence, right?
I mean,
more money goes into, like, you know, maintaining these military bases in Taiwan and Japan and Korea than go into, like, you know, like these abortion fundings that keep on going back and forth every time the administration changes, right?
Mm-hmm. I mean, that does sort of expand to another broader point I have on this is that, I mean, first off, I think if we are going to have allies, I don't think we should in good conscience be allied with with nations like Saudi Arabia, which, if we're supposed to be the bastion of freedom and democracy, why are we propping up and supporting countries which are the complete antithesis to this? I mean, Japan is more or less a fairly democratic, you know, it's obviously not like Saudi Arabia. It's a fairly free democratic nation, so there's not really an issue of us being allied with Japan and countries like Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. I don't really have a problem with us intervening in that sense, but of course, when it comes to the Middle East, absolutely not.
Go for it, Blackjack. Before you go, though, I think since we only have 20 more minutes, I think I'm going to kind of take a little bit of a step back from moderating and only moderate if people start interrupting. So since a few people dropped out of the chat, just I think we can just go on to direct question, direct answer. You don't have to wait for me to bring you in. If people start interrupting each other, I might change it, but go for it.
Okay. So as far as why we're allied with Saudi Arabia, just because that seems like the most pressing question, I would say that we're allied with Saudi Arabia because they help us keep the Middle East stable. They're more interested in a stable Middle East than they are expanding their own sphere of influence.
Is the Middle East stable?
Well, it's a lot better than it could be if we weren't supporting Saudi Arabia. Would you rather that Saudi Arabia, Syria, Iraq, Yemen, Oman, maybe even Jordan all be in a state of civil war? Would that be better than being allied with Saudi Arabia?
I'll say this, Blackjack. I actually highly sympathize with the stability above all thing, because I think it's fairly clear to me that at this point, after everything we've seen, that the Middle East is going to be under somebody's thumb. But I also don't think it's really incorrect that we shouldn't be thinking out of the box a little bit, right? Just because these current powers are the people currently ensuring stability, we should be looking to think a little bit. I mean, like, why is Iran necessarily an enemy, and why is Turkey an ally? That's not clear to me, right? But they both could ensure stability, right? So we should. Do you think we should have a little more of an open mind to this?
Well, the problem with Iran is that they're fundamentally opposed to the existence of Israel.
Why do we have to be fundamentally in favor of the existence of Israel?
Well, again, this goes back to the support of freedom and democracy. Israel is the only functioning democracy in that region.
Are they really a democracy, though? They actually.
Yes, they are really a democracy. They hold elections and everything.
No, but I actually hold on. I have a question. It's not clear to me that Turkey, for instance, we think Turkey is a great ally, right? But it's not so certain to me that Turkey is like. I think Turkey is actively working to undermine a piece of Israel. I think it's been clear for a very long time that that's the case. I'd be amazed if Erdogan wasn't involved in that.
I think that Turkey's just in it for themselves, honestly. I think Turkey just wants to take as much as they can and then, you know, form their new Ottoman Empire.
I don't see the difference between Persia and Turkey. That's the thing, right? American foreign policy elites seem to think that Turkey is all good and Persia and Iran is all bad. But they're just
I would agree with you there that Turkey, I think we need to dump Turkey as an ally.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, but then you're sitting with a Middle East where you don't have any large major power allies, right? Somebody is going to be in charge here, right? It's not going to be like chaos for 20 years.
Well, I understand what you're saying, but again, I'm saying that I do have a plan for if we dump Turkey, what we could do to replace them.
Oh, I love to hear.
I'm interested. What would it be?
Okay.
Yeah.
So after we dump Turkey, I think that Iran right now is up for grabs between us and Iraq is up for grabs between us and Iran. And I think that if we can establish a sort of a friendly, you know,
we could deploy our military there?
No, I mean like we could potentially end up with a situation where Iraq is a regional ally along with Saudi Arabia.
Iraq is a smashed wasteland right now.
No, It's relatively stable.
What are you talking about? The whole country is an armed militia. It's in the middle of a civil war. There's a sliver the one sliver that's at all stable is definitively allied with Iran.
I would not say definitively. I would say that it's up for grabs.
You think that the government in Baghdad right now is up for grabs in any meaningful way?
Yes, I do.
Okay, I've never heard that. That's interesting.
I'm not saying it would be easy, but I'm saying that it is definitely.
What would we offer them?
Well, just support in general, because Iran is more interested in supporting the government in Syria than it has been in Iraq.
No, I'm sorry to take this is kind of diverting from the hold on, but Iran's going to come to Iraq and go, "We're right next to you. We'll always be here, and we will always help you fight the Sunnis in the West." What's the United States offering you? And what are they going to say?
We could offer them, you know, again, because they're Arabs, they're not Persians, right? This is again, part of one of the many fun things about the Middle East is that, you know, there's not just a Sunni-Shia split. There's also an Arab-Persian split. There's an Arab-Kurd split. there's all sorts of
I understand there's lots of splits, but we're talking about the mainstay of the Iraqi population that is Shia and on the border of Iran.
Yeah, and they used to all hate the Persians, which are Iraqis. And they many of them maybe still do. Even if Iraq is not an option, I think that we could probably get maybe the United Kingdom, maybe even France to get involved in the Middle East in a meaningful way. Because
France and Britain are not going to have troops in the Middle East. That is not going to happen.
Are you sure about that? I mean, have you seen the way that they've been impacted?
I have never been more certain about a foreign policy pronouncement than what I've just said. France and Britain have no interest in foreign adventures in the Middle East. They'll do everything just to stop people from the Middle East coming to their countries. They're not going to go back into the Middle East.
So you don't see any way of making the case to them that getting involved in the Middle East is an actual, practical way of stopping the flow of migrants from stopping the flood of people.
I'm interested. How is getting involved in the Middle East going to stop the flood of people?
Also,
generally,
just
providing stability in the region.
The problem is that every time you keep intervening, you keep saying it provides stability. No, it doesn't. Every time you intervene,
it
makes it wait. When does
how
it?
How many refugees were running out of Iraq during the surge?
Okay,
here's the thing. How many troops were in Iraq at that point?
I'm not saying we need to keep that level of.
Guys, let's think about this systematically, okay? I agree that during the surge, it was relatively stable. I agree that when Western powers are physically there holding rifles, being the major military force occupying the country, things are relatively stable. But we're talking about long term, right?
Yeah. What
our experience has been is that the second those Western powers pull out, everything goes to hell. Unless there's another power that comes in and provides that stability.
Well, and the fact is it may be true that long-term occupation may provide stability. That's not going to happen because the populations of Western countries don't want to send their sons off to war have them being an occupying force for decades and decades. That's just not going to happen.
Can I ask you, Blackjack? If you're not advocating for occupation in the long term, then what are you advocating for? I guess.
Well, I'm advocating for basically a regional structure that
I like that. I like that.
What I said earlier about France having responsibility for providing stability in North Africa, in northern sub-Saharan Africa, you could do a similar thing. You could find a country like. Even Saudi Arabia would probably work. Saudi Arabia and Jordan would probably work as at least a somewhat effective force for providing stability in the region.
So you're going to take Jordanian and Saudi Arabian troops and put them in Iraq?
You could. They're both Arabs.
I know.
At the same, but then,
these
what about
are
like
countries that have almost no armies. They're.
Saudi Arabia has what? Saudi Arabia has a larger military budget than Russia.
Yeah,
I'm not saying that it's effective. It's definitely not effective.
They could be making planes out of gold for all I care about the oil money they have, but it doesn't mean they have an effective deployable force, which is large.
Oh, no. I would argue probably that the most effective deployable force in the Middle East right now would belong to Turkey.
Well, but that's where we started, right? I said in order to get stability, you have to negotiate something with Turkey or Iran. And
well,
this whole exercise was to say you could create order without Turkey or Iran. I don't think you can.
Okay, I'm not saying that the Saudi Arabia and Jordan thing is a solution for today. I'm saying that it's a possible one, that you could make an effective fighting force out of the armies. I mean, Jordan already has a relatively effective fighting force, but you could make the Saudi Arabian military an effective fighting force. If you just kicked them in the ass, sorry. If you just gave them a good swift kick, and sort of made them understand that they have to get their stuff together, I would say
you're talking about taking an army that's never really fought a foreign conflict, shipping it into a region where people hate them.
You mean,
and
no,
then
just
fighting,
right
and
next
fighting
door.
Against an army that is several times larger than theirs.
I don't think that's sustainable.
Okay, I'm not talking about open conventional conflict. If it ever got to open conventional conflict, then yes, I would say that there would be definitely Western powers would have to be involved. But I'm saying, as far as regional peacekeeping goes, that the Saudi
regional
Arabian
peacekeeping
military
in Iraq is conventional conflict. Like
no,
I know peacekeeping. I know peacekeeping is like, oh, we have these guns, we're walking around. No, the Iranian
there
Revolutionary
Guard. There's a fundamental
difference
between coin operations and conventional war.
No, but the Iranian Revolutionary Guard is very good at kicking up these little cluster Fs, you know, in areas that have large Shia populations. They did it in Yemen. They can do it in eastern Iraq.
And could they do it in Syria?
Well, I mean,
would they want to?
They're allies with Assad. I mean, they certainly can protect power there.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, well, there are large deployed formations of the Iranian Republican Guard in Syria right now. So
I mean, I almost think about this though. Is like, what does it benefit us to be involved in these countries? I mean,
exactly.
If the primary self-interest of keeping stability there is just to prevent migrants from coming, there is a way we could. Wouldn't it be wiser just to then invest in a way to make up a stopgap in Southern Europe and the Mediterranean just to prevent the migrants from coming in and not care about
what's
in the Middle East? Wouldn't it be a lot?
That's not what I want. I don't just want to stop migrants. I want to stop large-scale slaughter happening in Syria.
Well, you can.
That's another thing I would want to stop.
But I feel like
I don't know that.
I think.
Pius, what were you saying? You've been interrupted. What did you say?
I was going to say. I mean, as Anarcho said before, I don't really think we can have full-scale peace in the Middle East until there's either one religion or somehow we get secularism to work there. As things stand, I don't really think we can have peace as long as Islam is a dominant political force in the region.
Deus vult.
I have a thought experiment I've been thinking about. Does anyone ever think that, I mean, the Middle East, the people in the Middle East want to have an Islamic state? A thought experiment might be to allow one to exist. Controlled opposition.
Think about this. Wait, hold on. I do have
one at a time. Who's talking?
I do have something. Yeah, me. I mean, you sort of saw this with the Ottoman Empire in the late 19th and early 20th century, which that was effectively, in large part, controlled opposition by Germany and other Western powers. I guess that you did have a caliphate, you did have an Islamic caliphate over the Middle East, but it was one that was particularly very, very weak and had to be propped up by Christian powers.
Well, it was towards the end of its life. It certainly wasn't the beginning. But I think, you know, you could potentially see. I mean, the issue with an Islamic state, the benefit would be that it would be a controlled opposition. It would be a way for people to feel like they're getting what they want. The danger is that suddenly the Islamic state starts speaking for 1.5 billion people worldwide, and then it becomes a huge danger.
My ideal end situation, like I kind of see what you're seeing distributed.
It's
this
fault.
Is kind of what like but like what was it I think I might be agreeing with Al-Qaeda on this one. I think they actually had goals of a unified Islamic state for the Middle East. That could work only, and this is only if, and this is a big if, the Islamic state they set up could respect the idea of cultural parallelism, the idea of, okay, this is how we do things here. This is not something we can impose over there. Thing is, though, what I would love, I would think that would be the best case scenario. The
that
problem
seems
we have with that.
Particularly likely with an Islamic state. I mean,
and
this would have to be done in tandem with creating ethnic states for Christians and Kurds.
Well, I'm not even opposed to that in the future, but that's a whole nother. The thing is, though,
and also protecting
unifying
Israel.
Islam, the thing is, Islam, the Quran does specify plans for world domination. Like ISIS, when it says it wants a one world caliphate, is following the dictates of the Quran. So it's very difficult to say, you know, why can't we just have an Islamic State? The thing is, that Islamic State may not respect, you know, may want to expand its borders to the entire world very soon if we just, you know, let it as the Islamic State for so long.
I mean, it would be kind of amazing if it didn't, yeah. Actually.
Yeah, that.
Given what we've seen from these caliphates in previous eras.
You know, yeah,
my concern again, I think there's not really any evidence to believe that it wouldn't, because every time there's been unified Islamic state or caliphate, they've tried to start taking over the world.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's pretty much what happens every single time.
I mean, the only exception is, you know, the late Ottoman Empire, because it was so weak. I mean, it could barely...
Well, this is the second time you brought this up. The Ottoman Empire made 3 or 4 large-scale invasions in Europe that were just barely by the skin of the teeth of southern European countries turned back.
Yeah.
And I don't know exactly this Ottoman Empire being...
I'm not talking about when they're at the gates of Vienna. I'm talking about when, you know, they implored the Kaiser to ride through the streets of Jerusalem and build churches there. I'm talking about when they were fundamentally...
We were talking when they were so utterly weak that they couldn't do nothing but, yeah.
Yeah, but that would take a lot.
Caliphate will have
new. You would essentially have to build the caliphate and then utterly destroy it in war several times to get the same result.
This is the thing, guys. There's a certain reality.
The result would be, no, I mean, the intended goal would be.
There's a certain reality that's coming to the fact that Islam is going to be an increasingly powerful force. That's just a reality we have to deal with.
Yeah. Yep.
So I did want to ask something. So was the hypothetical caliphate like going to be like a puppet caliphate of like the Western powers, or was it like, was that like the goal
I proposed, or what?
Yes.
What are you?
What Frank is proposing, I think.
Oh, yeah. That's what I was proposing. Would be something. The idea would be a caliphate that was essentially control opposition, or, you know, essentially under the thumb of Western powers.
That makes sense.
Take all of the West and a good chunk of Asia to create, or to make the caliphate a puppet state, because that's a lot of people, that's a lot of military, and that's a lot of oil. Basically, the whole world would have to agree.
We could just try and start converting them all to Christianity, but
I think that's a long-term solution, Fritz.
Yeah, I think it would be easier just to nuke the entire region.
300 years.
Okay, we're getting into silly town now. I think the thing is, we have to consider the fact that there's just this reality. Islam will be the majority religion in the world.
Yeah.
And this is one of the reasons why this whole, like, we're just going to isolate ourselves. Well, Islam's going to be the majority religion in the world. So, it's going to be the biggest, single religion. Yes.
The thing is, these are projections in 50 years' time. Who the hell knows what's going to happen?
I think the population projections can... They've been somewhat reliable, I'll say.
Yeah, if the population boom continues as it is in Middle Eastern countries and with the migrants in Europe, Islam will be a dominant force in world politics if we don't do something.
Well, I don't think you can do.
I think it's going to be dominant.
Well, I mean, if we're putting forward crazy solutions, we could just stop feeding them. Because the Middle East imports vast amounts of food, we could just stop.
No, we're having a serious conversation here. I mean,
trying to discussion.
We're still keeping it serious. Then divide and conquer.
Divide and conquer. Okay.
Well, I would say nationalism. Sure, like I was saying, you know, Iraq, we can split up into 3 different nations. You know,
I would say not even along national lines. I would say that the arbitrary colonial ones work just fine.
I don't think they work well at all anywhere.
Well, okay, for divide and conquer, they do, because...
Well, they're obviously not, because there's a huge civil war there now, right?
Yeah, well, I think what Black Shrek is saying is that the civil war is part of the divide and conquer, in that they're fighting each other, so they weaken each other, which makes them susceptible for us then to intervene and then provide stability. Yeah. That's what I'm getting.
What was that guy's name? The crazy guy, the foreign policy guy that everybody hates? Kissinger, right? I mean, if we're going to go full, you know, the Prince Kissinger on it, then that would be the best. The Syrian civil war, the best outcome would be that it just continues. And we just sort of try to contain it.
Yeah. I can definitely
see
that.
I don't.
Wouldn't you say that that's the last thing we want? That the best thing for right now would be to end the civil war?
Yeah, I really don't.
If you care about Western continuity of culture at all, the Syrian civil war has to end.
Well, here's the thing.
Are millions of North African immigrants that's going to show up at Europe every single year? If that's going to happen, it's over, man.
Yeah. Let's say we were to let the civil war happen. If we were to deal with the migrant crisis, we'd have to start demanding that the Mideast and Africa and other Islamic countries, any Islamic countries for that matter, start taking in more migrants. I think that's got to be the trade-off. It's like, if you're going to expect us to weather any of this burden, you guys have to be willing to take in migrants as well. And,
you're not going to get that, though. You're never going to get that from them. This is the thing. There's
about diplomacy, honestly. I think...
What are you threatening?
A bunch of tanks there, and say, "Hey, you guys should let in migrants," like what we did to Japan.
You're going to invade them?
Well, with Saudi Arabia, we can sanction them and cut off our oil.
We can cut off the food that we send to them.
We could also do that.
Serious here, like, look.
Why is that not serious?
Unbold diplomacy is nasty, but it is.
Food is bought on a world market. One country cutting off the food doesn't cut the food supply coming in. They can buy it from any other country in the world. All fungible. So, and they're a rich country, so they're not going to starve to death. I mean, understanding of how economics works. They understand that there's a limit to the America's ability to literally invade them. And they're not going to do something. They understand. The second they let migrants in, every single country in the Middle East does this. The second they let migrants in is the second they have the potential for a civil war on their hands. Civil war means they die. You're not going to get them to let migrants into their country, period.
Why does it mean a civil war?
Because that means they have a ton of people that they can't track who are most likely ISIS, who are going to stir up conflicts and create cells. If they can't account for that, their country's done.
And also, the fact is, they love that, you know, Muslims are flooding into Europe because that expands Islam.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't think it's nearly that cynical. They like it because it relieves pressure. They can deport their radicals to Europe and have Europe deal with the problem, right? They don't have to deal with a lot of 20-something fighting-age men milling around their country, you know, looking for trouble to get into. They can just let Europe handle that. It's going to be the consequence of a destabilized Middle East is going to be millions and millions of migrants flowing into Europe.
I mean,
unless something really changes, that's the reality of the matter.
I mean, what if Europe, what happens if Europe?
Leaving aside the humanitarian. I mean, like she said this too, I'm also like, I mean, millions of people dying, and it's, you know, there's a humanitarian dimension to that too. Sorry, Fritz, what was that?
I'm saying is like, if the migrant crisis keeps happening to Europe, what will happen to the Europeans? Will they eventually just start electing far-right leaders?
I don't know. I mean, they're not electing far-right leaders now. Who knows? It's an open question. But at any rate, what's going to happen is something is going to eventually destabilize Europe. That seems apparent.
And destabilize it as in, as in what?
Well, I mean,
What does destabilized Europe look like? An end of the EU?
Yeah, that's certainly one of them.
Well, that's not a really bad thing.
An
end to the EU, a dissolution of a lot of trading and immigration relationships between countries, economic chaos.
Yeah, it'll hurt in the short run, but those can be rebuilt.
At least countries will start getting an identity back and stop trying to murder their own population.
If you destroy your identity, that can't be easily recovered.
Hold on, guys. I'm going to clarify here. This is listed as a benefit for having millions of immigrants flow, millions of refugees flown to Europe.
Wait,
millions of immigrants flowing into Europe is an effective way to get rid of the EU.
That seems to be a result. I mean, that was I imagine that was part of a large part of the decision, went into the decision for the British for Brexit. But I'm not, obviously it's not a good thing to have.
It seems like you're putting the cart before the horse. I mean, it seems like you could say, well, we can totally destabilize and cause a civil war in Europe and then the EU will be gone. It seems like
burning down your house
to, like, you know, so you, because you don't like the wallpaper or whatever.
Well, no, I'm trying to burn the house because the house is trying to kill me.
It's essentially doing that puts yourself in a prey situation, like psychologically, which is never something that you want to do to yourself, because other people can tell when you're acting like a prey.
What does that?
Flooding in like tens of millions of migrants in hopes that it might work out okay.
That's what Merkel's doing.
Well, yeah, I don't think she's doing
I get what you're saying, distributors. I'm just thinking, like, perhaps a better way of saying this is that this isn't something that I want to root for. I mean, I do want the EU to go away. Obviously, I don't think that. And, of course, I don't want the reason for it to be because there's millions of migrants. I would have loved it if the Europeans could have decided to not enter into the EU in the first place.
So if you don't want millions of migrants, then you want stability in the Middle East.
Yes, I do. I want stability in the Middle East. And I think that American intervention does not allow for that.
Who doesn't want?
We have four more minutes before.
No, ISIS does. They just want stability under a one-world caliphate.
Okay, we have four more minutes before this broadcast ends. So I guess we'll just go through. You guys can just comment on the situation in general in the Middle East, but I'd like to give everyone a little bit of time to respond. Now, okay. So we only have 3 minutes. Please be as succinct as possible. Let's start with Blackjack.
Okay. So I think the main thing that we can all take away from this is that, you know, even the isolationists aren't pure isolationists in all cases. So really, I think that the most important thing is that we ought to recognize that however this ends up, the United States will be involved in the solution, whether we like it or not. So we might as well just start planning for it.
Okay, great. Pius?
In conclusion, I honestly think that there's obviously no easy solution to this, but it's wildly clear that any further American intervention into the Middle East is not going to help matters in any way. I think that if we try to do something beyond exterminating the Islamic State, it's just going to do more harm than good in the long run.
Great. Anarcho?
So I would agree with Blackjack that most isolationists or non-interventionists, whatever term you want to use, are not purists, in that we recognize that, yes, some military intervention is unavoidable. However, as a general rule of thumb, when it comes to Western intervention and Islam, it's better to stay out and not try to stir up the pot or whack the hornet's nest any more than you have to.
Okay, great. Fritz?
Yeah, again, I think that either military intervention in the Middle East makes things worse, or the military intervention that would be required to ensure stability, we do not have the resources, money, or political will to do that.
Great. Josh?
Read the Dictator's Handbook. I don't know. Not much else to say. It's
So I'll lead off on the last minute. So I think this is the reality of the world we live in. Islam is going to be a major, major cultural world force. The Middle East is the key to Islam. It's where most of the Muslim power center lies, and it's going to be an increasingly vital source, whether it's a source of conflict or a source of basically just political will. If the Middle East is destabilized, Europe is going to face a ongoing and unending flood of refugees that will never end. And I'm not so sure it can sustain it in its current form. I think the only option is to really do something to ensure stability, which will involve making some kind of deal with Turkey and Iran, and then hope that we can get our act together in the meantime.
And make sure Assad wins.
That's just my prescription. So I'd like to thank everyone for participating in the first roundtable. I'd like to hear from the commenters how you thought this went, how we can modify it, how we can make it better for last time. As always, the debates last exactly 2 hours. We don't go over. So I'm going to thank all of the participants for sharing their opinions, and we'll continue offline. Have a good night.